Enjoy. Eric, come forth. We clap for him as he comes all the way from Nigeria. Oga, oh. Oga, Oga, Oga. He say, oh. Thank you.
Called the Happy Wanderer. Happy Wanderer. I'm doing it because I want all of us to join when I'm singing it. So, it's an old music, it's an old song, and I want you to join me when I'm singing it. You know it's join. There are my knapsack on my back. So you don't know it. Okay, let me sing a song. Because you don't know this one. I am singing a song uniting all of us in one love. Give me your ears now. Borete lo letore movero to Moritere mavero lo secru beto ferate Movedo verino peto naira nei Vino per mettere l'età, vino per davvero te.
Ma ne, io le pena non arena, io vita ramona, come ritero di mattina.
Ma ne, me, io le ne si con me,
me lo sete nella verità, vino per me ne colena. Ma ne, io te ne vina di curande, mo vita la sega rovela, mo vita la tavola.
Mamma mia, ora mi tiro vennero, muovere care se la beta,
vino della Maria Tena.
Ma vorrei, ora tiro per i cuori lei, muovi cara te la sole, muovi cara i cuori. Mamma mia, quando mi vengiana nanna, abu moni buona biara malvia, a camana la venna.
Mamma me, ma vida de quedar en no veré, movi será cala vena.
People, let me go, let me go, let me go.
Thank you, clap for him. I wish I had voice like his, but you know, we appreciate, Eric, we appreciate, thank you. You clap for him again, please. Good. Now, at this point, we have to sit academically as well as spiritually. Because we have a very important person who will want to speak to us on the African women as models of courage, insights from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, verses 1 to 3. And this is Ozowulu Consmas from Nigeria. Please clap for him as he comes up.
Donc nous avons une allocution qui sera donnée par Prof Ozowulu. Et donc on écoute.
Everybody, Before I begin, I want to make a comment because this is a conversation. In the morning section, we spoke about women, and there is an issue I want to make a simple comment before I begin talking about my paper. We had a discussion like this that the role of women, Mary and the others, are almost the same. Any discussion on that level has to look at, first of all, the scriptures, secondly, the sacred tradition, which with the scripture forms what we call a single depositum fidei, one single deposit of faith, and then the teaching of the magisterium. Based on these facts from the scriptures, Mary has a different role from other women. The Gospel of Luke makes it clear when the angel Gabriel came and spoke to Mary using such expression, Kaire Maria Kekaritomene, Hokurios Metatu, Hail Mary, full of grace, Kekaritomene. No other person is, you know, that expression was never used on any other creature. Though in the Gospel of John, when Jesus addressed the woman of Samaria by calling her Gune, and that's the same word he used for Mary on the cross, Gune, but that is not, that's a different interpretation. So Mary has a different role, both from the scriptures, the sacred tradition of the church, and the teaching of the magisterium. Having said that, I just talked to my paper, Luke chapter 8, 1 to 3. And the summary of that is, Jesus was traveling around with the 12 and three women and other unnamed women. Is important to take note of that. In the Gospel of Luke, he has perhaps, I might call it, a lot of sympathies for women, but it's not just sympathy. Because if we believe in the canonical test that every scripture is inspired by God, it's not just a simple sympathy. There is an important point Luke and Jesus wants to make. In this passage, which is unique to Luke, two sets of travelers followed Jesus on the way. The first group was the 12, whom Luke introduced as the 12. Not even the apostles. He called in the 12. How about the named women and unnamed women who are mentioned together with the 12? What does that mean? If the 12 preached, Luke does not tell us in this context. His interest lies in informing his readers about the women who are accompanying the party this time and enables so many to travel from one town and village to another. It is illuminating that the expression 12 is employed here instead of apostles, since these terms are often used interchangeably. The significance of the 12 as a sign of the new covenant built upon the tradition of the 12 tribes of Israel was seen as central to God's plan for humankind. By placing the women side by side with the 12, the redactor attains the effect of including them in this new covenant. Along with some other points, the Lucan author wished to make by means of this summary is that the women we are expected to be sharers of this new covenant, even supporting it through their own wealth. Everyone is invited and expected to be part of this new reality. And I think that's what the synodality is all about. The effect of adding these women to a mention of the 12 is not, as some feminist exegetes protest, to make the women a group alongside the disciples, who are all men, or to subordinate them to the 12, but rather to single out the 12 and the women as two outstanding groups within the larger body that Luke names the disciples of Jesus, called Matetes, no distinction. This is clear from the larger context in the Lucan Gospel. It is also supported by Luke chapter 24, verse 6, where the angels at the tomb informed the women to remember how he told them, no distinction between men and women. He told them. Luke's resurrection narratives refer to the disciples in such a way as to make clear that not only the 11, but a larger group are in view, and also that the women belong to this larger group. When the women return from the tomb, they report to the 11 and all the rest, the travelers to Emmaus, not members of the 11, are called literally two from them. That is, two of their company. And the travelers themselves refer to the women with an exactly parallel expression. Some women of our group. So no distinction based on this context. In addition to the 12, a group of women travel with Jesus and sustain his ministry. The evangelist Luke appears to establish a deliberate parallel between the apostles and the women. His gospel is marked, characterized by such paralleling of men and women. Think about Zechariah, an old man that angel appeared in the temple. And immediately after that, the angel appeared to a young woman outside the temple. He talks about the Simeon, the prophet. Luke mentioned also the prophetess Anna. And we continue the list ad infinitum. So what Luke is doing here, the two genders, men and women, have the same function as long as discipleship is involved. Like the disciples, these women were with Jesus during his ministry, and we are part of the group of those to whom the risen Lord appeared. These women witnessed the execution of Jesus. We are the first to encounter the empty tomb, and we are the exclusive recipients of the message that Jesus was alive once more. Indeed, from Luke's own perspective, these women are the only witnesses to the burial of Jesus, and in fact, only they are brought into connection with all four stages of traditional confession we call the kerygma, preserved also in the letter of Paul. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 3 to 5. Death, they were there. Burial, they were there. Empty tomb, they were the first. Resurrection appearances, they were the first. However, first among these women is Mary of Magdala. She always appears as the first among these women, just as Peter appears as the first among the male disciples. After this first, we talk about Joanna. Is an indication that the message of Jesus has penetrated into the high places, the political world of the Jewish world. It's also an indication in Africa that also the message of Jesus has to penetrate to the highest level of political strata. The last of these women is Susanna. This is the only place she appeared in the New Testament. But then the point is this, that these women go hand in hand as long as the discipleship is involved. with a male counterpart. D, there are good Jewish parallels for women providing for the rabbis and their followers out of their own money, property, or foodstuffs. But the women here are far more intimately caught up in the ministry in which Jesus is engaged. Not just only providing food, they were engaged. But the women here are far more intimately caught up in the ministry in which Jesus is engaged. The women supported the whole group as a reflection of their faith and thereby picture an exemplary response to Jesus and his mission. And that's what is expected of every woman and every man to do in this synodal process. The fundamental pattern of ministry in response to grace is a prominent theme of the pericope under study. Those who enter the community are not spectators to the ministry. Rather, they use their gifts and resources in service to Jesus, whether delivered from the power of demons or sent from the courts of the kings. These women give to make effective ministry possible. Part of their ministry is to minister to the good news. The view of women today differs significantly from the first century. Many women are as educated and qualified for various roles as men, as we can see during this conference. And many serve with distinction in various capacities. In light of the more traditional distinctions the church has made between the role of men and women, this test has produced much questioning about whether women can do everything in the church, including those functions the New Testament had limited to men. In the midst of the debate about the role of women, we should never lose sight of one thing. I repeat, we should never lose sight of one thing. That we are all called to serve the Lord by serving one another as disciples. One of the great regrets in the current discussion of the role of women is that the discussion has centered on power, fueled more by cultural standards than biblical standards of service. Even some of those tests that uphold the headship of the male do so as a way to point to service, not to the callous exercise of raw power. More attention to these themes might lessen the battles on other matters. Luke chapter 8, verses 1 to 3 highlights three women for special mention who ministers with their resources. In dealing with ministry and resources, we can champion two equally dangerous imbalances. Number one, we can look at ministry as simply a matter of throwing money at a need. But ministry without heart, even well-financed ministry, is not ministry in the sight of God. A ministry can possess the best equipment, finest quality of buildings, and the largest many lists, and still not be doing God's work with quality if people do not remain more important. I think that is exactly what our Supreme Pontiff is emphasizing. Number two, the opposite error is to argue that resources do not matter and the best and are best left undiscussed. No, it also matters. Yes, I know, I'm about to stop. Yeah. So, dearest friends, the point I'm trying to make is simple. In our church, in Africa, particularly in Nigeria, in the northern part of the country, where predominantly we have Muslims, believe that these women are being subjugated. Many of them have assumed prominent roles as chairpersons in different parishes and have prominent roles in the church. Including in the South, many dioceses and parishes are engaging them and they are having prominent positions globally. Recently, As Supreme Pontiff, apart from other appointments, I recently appointed 3 women, 2 nuns, and 1 woman who belongs to the consecrated virgins to the dicastery of bishops, those who will sit down and evaluate the candidates for the office of bishop. So things are changing, and this is actually the conversation we should be having in a conference like this. We shouldn't be afraid to discuss anything. And I think that is where the Spirit is working. Thank you for listening.
Edit the Bible, we'll say all women of the group, not some women, because we want to belong. And here we are. This is our evening. We belong. And that's the reason why I would call upon everyone to clap for Cosmas as we thank him for what he shared with us. Yeah, and the clubs, all those clubs have come from women, so we appreciate. Thank you. Yeah. Now, we will listen to one song, and those who know the song can sing along with the singers. It's by Angelique. The song is Redemption Song. DJ.
All pirates, yes, the rabbi, sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit, but my hand was made strong. I didn't hear a beat of mine. Forward in this generation, triumphantly, won't you help to sing?
This time round, only one song. Only one. Thank you. and join them. If the Spirit is telling, calling you, please join them. Join them.
Donc ce soir, nous écoutons professeur Mary Getui qui nous parlerait de Mama Africa, pilier et phare de l'espoir et de la transformation.
Good evening.
You are tired, huh? We request for just a few more minutes. I will not be long. I want to appreciate those who have spoken before me and the presentation. You may not get all the words, but the movements tell you that there's strength and determination in women. I appreciate the opportunity. I was told I have less than 10 minutes to just talk about Mama Africa. In these 10 minutes, I'm not sure what to say. Just a few points. And the first one is, I wish I brought it. It could have been projected. There's a picture, you could call it a cartoon, of an African woman with many projections of hands. In one hand, she's a mother. The other hand, she's in the office. The other hand, she's tending to the farm, and on and on. You look at that picture, she's doing at least 24 tasks at the same time. Studies have shown that the African woman works at least 18 hours a day. So she could be a mother, she could be a wife, she could be a teacher, she could be a nurse. She is one of those who are sitting here in this room tonight. Last Friday, a dear friend, a close friend, Dr. Lydia Wakanyi, Kahindi of Kenyatta University, was laid to rest after a very short time of illness. I attended the funeral service. I didn't stay to the end, but in that service, there was a very strong presence of the Catholic Women Association. I'll come back to that. She was described in the program here in Kenya, when somebody rests, we make a program and there are tributes from various people. Her children described her as a strong woman, a leader, hard worker, diligent, who had love for education, love for the church, and many, many, many other tributes. And her daughter said, "Mother, you overcame the tag that is given to single mothers, and you overcame all that to bring us up." We worked with Lydia for many years. I remember when her sister died, who had two children, Lydia took over as the mother and the parent of these children. She was a very close friend, but what I didn't know is that she actually breastfed the younger of those children, who was just months old. And there are many, many things said about this woman, which could be said about very many women in Africa. But I just want to concentrate on one of those attributes said of her, her love for the church and the groups that she joined. When I worked in Kenyatta University, Lydia was the leader of the welfare group in our department. And even long after I'd left Kenyatta University, Lydia continued to play the role of welfare in my life. So her children say that she derived her strength from the groups that she joined. And one of these was the Catholic Women Association. And at St. Paul's University Chapel, where she worshipped, she was appointed the moderator of this group. As we are talking about transformation of the church, synodal relationships, I want to briefly address what the Catholic Women Association does or have done. The year 2020, the eve of the International Women's Day, which comes in March, about 20,000 women of the Catholic Women Association gathered in one of our shrines in this country. And Archbishop Anthony Muheria addressed this women. One of the things that comes out is that they gathered barefoot. What could be the implications of this? He describes these women as stewards of love, as those people who make sure that our families or our houses are places which we call home. Those of us here in Kenya know that we make a difference between house and home. House is a structure. Home is where we have our roots and where we have our sense of belonging. So these are the women who make our families or who make our houses our homes. They bring harmony. They are stewards. They are welcoming. Stewards in the sense that there'll be very little food, but Mother, Mama Africa, will make sure that everyone in the family gets something to eat. We do not use the earthenware pot anymore. In the rural areas, it's still used. But what I gather is the principle that Mama would look and realize that this food will not go round, but some people have already had a share. And she would pass her hand in the pot and say, there is actually nothing. You have had something, there is nothing now left. And what she has done is that she has stuck a little of this food the side of the pot, so that that boy who has gone out there to graze will come home and find something to eat. Stewards, maybe that example is just enough. Bishop Muheria also challenged these mothers and told them, you are our main soldiers. Soldiers. I saw friends here that we worked with, we journeyed with when I worked with the National AIDS Control Council. And one of our mottos there was that in any battle, there'll always be one survivor, a soldier, a main soldier left. And Bishop Muheria challenged these mamas to be worried, W-A-R-Y, of peddlers of evil, peddlers of corruption, that they can speak against the evil in the society, beacons of hope and transformation. He also sees, or he also told these women, they are giants in faith and in love. Remember, my friend, the coordinator or the moderator of the Catholic Women Association at St. Paul's University Chapel, they described her as a giant of faith. What is my message for us tonight? It is that women and women associations have a role to play in the society. And I want to quote again the words of Anthony Muheria, Archbishop. He said, women can help God change our hearts from evil to good. God is God. He doesn't really need help. But from what we have been gathering in this conference, in our palavers, is that we need to reflect. We need to reflect. And I think in this reflection, wondering why it is us who are here at this time in history, why it is that we have this chance of being here in this conference, why is it that the theme we are handling is the theme that we are handling this time? It is because there's so much that has gone wrong, and we need change, and we need transformation, and we need hope. And so women are seen as agents of change. What would one gain from joining or being a member of the Catholic Women Association is that their spiritual growth could be enhanced. How much we need that day by day. I'm not Catholic. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. But my formation in primary school, in secondary school, and even now, I work at the Catholic University of Eastern Africa. Once a year, the Adventist Church, we have a moment when we just reflect about women and issues of women. And a few years ago, there are many, many good things that have been said and done, but one thing which struck me is that women are soldiers in prayer. And prayer, early morning, prayer alone is part of spiritual growth. And when we grow spiritually, then we can pass this to others. What can one benefit from being a member of the Catholic Women Association is that they can participate more effectively in evangelization and sanctification of humanity. Evangelization. Yesterday we heard about how God is working. Today, those of you made a visit on Sunday to various places in this Nairobi. How much we need evangelization and sanctification of humanity. And that at the Catholic Women Association, you are a member, you have an opportunity to participate in seminars, in retreats, to visit the sick, to visit children's homes, to be concerned about environmental issues, to be part of those special days when we consider the issues of women and about women. And that this is an opportunity for us to participate actively in parish activities, in deanery, in diocesan and national activities. I believe also that by being a member of the Catholic Women Association and by being encouraged to participate in those activities, it is an opportunity for us to be together as a group. The small Christian communities in my church, we call them the prayer cells or the home churches. There's a lot of strength in being together. Father Healy told us yesterday that you want to walk fast, walk alone. But if you want to walk far, walk together, walk with others. I'm in a board which is very keen on early childhood. And one of the concerns of that association has been what happens to the children who go to prison with their mothers. There are many questions about single women, single mothers, widows, abused women in many ways. So friends, for me, the Catholic Women Association is one of those institutions that needs to be appreciated, to be strengthened, because from them and with them, we can see pillars and beacons of hope and transformation for the church in Africa. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sister Mary. And I wish you, I know some of us in this house, when Mary started speaking about the CWA, did not understand. She will eventually say that she's not even a Catholic. She's SDA. And actually, she's championing for the Catholic Women Association. And for those who are here and you are not members of that group, because of her, please, can you join next Sunday, go to church and tell the chair lady to enroll you to become a member of the Catholic Women what Association. Are we together with the mothers in the house? You will clap for her again, because what she has just said is actually speaking to us as women and giving us an understanding of the importance of belonging to a particular association in the church where you are affiliated to.
Donc nous sommes contents d'écouter ce qui est dit ce soir. Il faut souligner qu'elle n'est pas catholique. Pour autant, elle prend la place, elle fait la publicité pour l'organisation des femmes catholiques. Et si on l'écoute bien, elle nous souligne l'importance, le rôle que les femmes jouent dans la famille. Elle dit, ce sont eux qui s'occupent, qui s'assurent qu'il y a à manger. Et même quand il n'y a pas à manger, elles font toujours des miracles. Être une manière de faire de telle en sorte que tout le monde a quelque chose. Et donc, mais elle souligne, elles ne le font pas seules, elles s'associent. Et une des associations, c'est l'association des femmes catholiques. Et donc, si une personne qui n'est pas catholique insiste, nous parle de l'importance de cette association, il est important que les catholiques le prennent au sérieux. Parce que, comme elle dit, et comme Mumbi l'a dit il y a deux jours, si vous voulez aller loin, si vous voulez aller vite, allez seul. Mais si vous voulez aller loin, il faut y aller ensemble.
Thank you. I now call upon the Zoko team. Please come forward, the Zoko team, for 1 minute. The Zoko team, before we go to the next activity. Zoko team, come forward. Much time, so large. And anyone can join them after the song begins.
Mambo.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you. Now, we are here for a reason, and it's time now. It's time now that I call upon my brother and sister, Sister Mombi, and Father Emmanuel. And I also call upon Mary Getui and Sir Sia Solaj to come forward. And as they come, you just clap for them. I'll tell you the reason why they're coming forward. This evening, we have an event that actually I never mentioned when we started our gathering this evening, because I wanted to make it special. And this speciality comes because I know, you know from the programs that we had, those of you attending the Congress, today we are celebrating women, and it's an evening of women, and that's why we are here. Please, the men in the house, the men in the house, yeah. Can you clap for the women in this house? Actually worked lengths and then lengths to make sure that things happen. And we've just said mambo sawa sawa because with Jesus things are possible. And now we say mambo sawa sawa because with women things are possible. And that is not possible, but things are doing what? Are happening. Are we together? And we are here to honor these women as as icons of various moments of their life. And I would like at this point and time, to appreciate the presence of these women in this house. And we appreciate the fact that they've accepted to come and they have accepted our invitation this evening.
Donc aujourd'hui, c'est la journée des femmes. Et comme vous le savez, depuis le commencement de ce projet, les femmes sont en tête de choses. Elles font bouger des activités, que ce soit à l'aéroport, que ce soit ici. Mais au-delà d'ici, nous avons aussi des femmes qui font bouger l'Église. Nous les avons écoutées hier et dans la société en général. Donc ce soir, nous voudrions, de manière particulière, souligner l'apport de ces femmes dans nos mondes, dans notre monde et dans nos sociétés différentes. Et pour cela, nous allons passer la parole à Emmanuel et Mumbi qui, ce soir, vont nous aider à les appeler.
Thank you. In no particular order, our first honoree of the evening is Leonora Obara. Leonora, you can start proceeding to the front. Leonora Obara was born in Busia County in the western part of Kenya in 1963. She moved to Nairobi at the age of 7 when her father, who worked for Kenya Railways, moved to Nairobi. She joined Our Lady of Mercy Girls School at the age of 7, followed by high school at Huruma Girls for her O-levels. When her parents could not afford to pay for her A-levels, Undugu Society took her on and paid for her training as a social worker. After completing her studies, she worked for several NGOs, which she continues to do to this day. Her inspiration to run Kijiji Cha Upendo Children's Home, which was co-founded with her husband, was inspired by their own experience of taking care of vulnerable children in their own home. Between the years of 2000 and 2004, they took care of 15 orphan children who had lost their parents to HIV/AIDS. In 2007, she got the opportunity to visit Canada to share her experience as a social worker, taking care of orphans and vulnerable children in a number of slums throughout Nairobi. While in Canada, some people took interest in her work based on her own personal story. As she says, when she took the children in, all she had to give them was love. One Canadian lady invited her for dinner, and then this lady made a trip to Kenya and witnessed to this experience, and upon her return to Canada, formed a group with other people and started supporting these children. Her popularity and her work became known, and people began knocking on her door asking her to take in more children. And finally, with her husband and a Canadian by the name Olive Brown, they came together to start Kijiji Cha Upendo. Love is their motivation, and as she says, it's something that costs nothing to offer to children. They started with 15 women. As they started, most of these women could only provide a meal a day. But as of now, they have 91 families they are reaching, and more than 500 women through different services.
We celebrate you for your big heart of love, for your generosity of spirit, and for walking the talk.
Léonard Obara est né dans le comté de Busia, dans la partie occidentale du Kenya, en 1963. Il a déménagé à Nairobi à l'âge de 7 ans lorsque son père, qui travaillait pour le chemin de fer Kenyan, a déménagé à Nairobi. Il a rejoint l'école des filles à Aurelio Mercy à l'âge de 7 ans, puis l'école secondaire pour Roma Girls pour obtenir son baccalauréat. Lorsque ses parents n'ont pas pu lui payer son baccalauréat, la société Udungo l'a prise en charge et a payé sa formation de travailleur social. Après l'avoir terminé, elle a travaillé pour des ONG et c'est ce qu'elle fait encore aujourd'hui. Son inspiration pour diriger les maisons d'enfants Kijiji wa Upendo, qu'elle a cofondée avec son mari, lui a été donnée par leur propre expérience de prise en charge d'enfants vulnérables dans leur propre maison. Entre 2000 et 2004, ils ont pris soin de 15 orphelins qui avaient perdu leurs parents à cause du sida. En 2007, elle a eu l'occasion de se rendre au Canada pour partager son expérience des travailleurs sociaux s'occupant d'orphelins et d'enfants vulnérables dans un certain nombre de bidonvilles de Nairobi. Pendant son séjour au Canada, certaines personnes se sont intéressées au travail et à son travail en raison de l'histoire personnelle qu'elle a vécue en s'occupant de ses enfants. Comme elle l'a dit elle-même, lorsqu'elle a accueilli ses enfants, tout ce qu'elle avait à leur donner, c'était plutôt de l'amour. Une dame l'a invité à dîner avec lui et lui a dit que les enfants dont elle s'est occupée sont traités de la même manière que ses propres filles et fils biologiques. Cette femme a fait un voyage au Kenya pour visiter et témoigner de cela en présence. Et à son retour au Canada, elle a formé un groupe avec sept autres personnes et a commencé à soutenir les enfants de son foyer. Avant de travailler à Kibera pendant un certain temps, les gens ont commencé à frapper à sa porte pour lui demander de s'occuper des enfants qu'il connaissait. Finalement, avec son mari André et une Canadienne, Olive Brown, ils se sont réunis pour créer Kijiji wa Upendo. L'amour est leur motivation et c'est quelque chose qui ne coûte rien à offrir aux enfants. Ils ont créé un groupe de 15 femmes à Kibera et ont reçu leur premier financement. Ils ont commencé à soutenir ces femmes en leur offrant une formation et en amenant ces enfants à l'école. Au début, la plupart d'entre elles ne pouvaient fournir qu'un repas par jour. Mais au fur et à mesure que le projet s'est développé, a-t-elle dit, nous les avons soutenus dans leurs affaires. Nous leur avons fourni des services psychosociaux et les avons formés à d'autres activités génératrices de revenus. Au fur et à mesure que leurs activités ont augmenté, leur estime de soi s'est accrue. Actuellement, nous comptons 91 familles et nous touchons 500 enfants, 500 femmes par le biais des différents services. Elle a travaillé en partenariat avec les services gouvernementaux pour la santé, l'éducation, la protection de l'enfant et d'autres acteurs de la communauté. Léonara, nous te célébrons pour ton grand cœur et ton amour, pour ta générosité et pour ton esprit de fraternité et pour ta volonté d'agir.
Thank you so much, the organizers of this conference, for inviting me to participate. I'll not say much. Women are pillars of hope, and indeed, I'm a pillar of hope. But a pillar is supported to hold whatever it's supposed to hold. So I take this opportunity to thank my loving husband, Andrew Barra, for his support. I also thank my children in absentia for their support. And I will not forget to thank Father Stan Chu Ilo, who is also a professor, who came from Nigeria. He inspired us, and through the Canadian Samaritan Africa, he's been able to help us to transform the lives of women and vulnerable children in Kebra. Asante sana.
La deuxième personne à recevoir, la révérende sœur Angélique Namaïka. La sœur Angélique Namaïka est responsable de l'association prieuse de la bienheureuse Anwarite de compassion de Dungu-Duruma, qui est une association de vie religieuse en RDC. Elle s'occupe des enfants orphelins. Et dans la ville de Duruma, elle est reconnue pour son grand cœur et pour son amour pour les enfants abandonnés. Elle travaille en ce moment en partenariat avec les services gouvernementaux pour différents nombreux services. Révérende sœur, nous vous honorons pour votre esprit pionnier et votre ministère rempli de foi auprès des plus vulnérables et pour votre réponse courageuse à l'invitation de l'Esprit-Saint.
Sister Angélique Namaïka is a founding sister of the Pious Association of the Blessed Anwarite of Compassion
of Dungu-Duruma, which is an association of religious life in the DRC.
Having been born in Kembisa in DRC
in a modest family,
and educated by the Augustinian sisters of Dungu-Duruma, she made her first vows
in the same congregation and also her perpetual vows. She then went to Kinshasa, where she studied African spirituality and obtained her diploma and became a formator. To fulfill her aspiration to serve the needy, Sister Angélique requested an exclaustration from the Augustinian sisters, and on the 21st of April 2014, Sister Namaïka created a community life structure for the care of children who had lost their parents or been abandoned by their parents. When she expressed her dream to the ordinary, Bishop Richard Dombar, he gave her an episcopal decree in 2020, giving her the authorization to open a pious association, which she named Blessed Anwarite of Compassion. Since its creation until today, she has been the Mother General. She has 2 novices and 35 aspirants. In 2013, UNHCR also gave her an award of the Nansen Prize for her work, and the Comboni Fathers also awarded her the Mundo Negro. We honor you, Sister Angélique, for your pioneer spirit and faith-filled ministry to the most vulnerable, and your courageous response to the invitation of the Spirit.
Merci beaucoup pour ces honneurs qui reviennent à Dieu, lui le promoteur de toutes les choses dans le monde. Je le remercie avant tout. Et je remercie les réseaux à travers le président Abbé Stanislas. Il va me pardonner pour l'appeler en français. Pour le choix qu'il a fait de pouvoir me classer parmi les femmes de ce jour que nous célébrons ensemble. Il a fait attention avec son équipe à ce travail qui s'est fait au coin du Congo, à Dungu. Je vous remercie, vous tous. Je remercie également les enfants pour qui je voyage. Je découvre les milieux. Je vous rassure, vous qui m'avez donné ces cadeaux, ces prix, je vais l'amener aux propriétaires, les enfants orphelins et les femmes vulnérables. Merci beaucoup.
Cahill, represented by her two biological sisters, whom I'm going to welcome to the front, Irene and Judy. Sister Jane Wakahill is a member of the Institute of the Little Sisters of St. Francis, Kenya. She serves as Associate Vice President of Programs, Operations, and Head of Catholic Sisters Initiative at the Conrad Hilton Foundation. Her responsibilities include advancing the vitality of congregations of women religious globally and enabling sisters to contribute more profoundly to sustainable human development, as well as enhancing the effectiveness of Catholic schools in the Archdiocese of Los Angeles. Prior to joining the foundation, Wakahill was the executive director of the African Sisters Education Collaborative, where she implemented many programs by working closely with leadership conferences, major superiors, religious congregations and institutes, 23 partner colleges and universities in the United States and Africa, and many major foundations. Sister Wakahill has also taught at the undergraduate and graduate level. She is an author and editor of 3 books, holds a PhD in Human Development and Higher Education Administration, a Master of Arts degree from St. Bonaventure University, and a Bachelor of Education from this university where we are, the Catholic University of Eastern Africa. We honor you, Sister Jane, for being a trailblazing woman religious, being the first African woman to occupy your previous and current ministerial positions, and here to accept the award are her biological sisters, Judy Wakahill and Irene Minor.
La sœur Jeanne Wakahill est membre de l'Institut des Petites Sœurs de Saint-François au Kenya. Elle est vice-présidente de l'Association des opérations et programmes. Elle est aussi responsable de l'initiative des sœurs catholiques à la Fondation Conrad Hilton en Californie aux États-Unis. Elle est chargée de promouvoir la vitalité des congrégations des femmes religieuses dans le monde et de permettre aux sœurs de contribuer plus profondément au développement humain durable, ainsi que d'améliorer l'efficacité des écoles catholiques de l'archidiocèse à Los Angeles. Avant de rejoindre la Fondation, la sœur Wakahill était directrice exécutive de African Sisters Education Collaborative, où elle a mis en œuvre de nombreux programmes en travaillant en étroite collaboration avec des conférences des directions, des supérieurs majeurs, des congrégations et instituts religieux, 23 collèges et universités partenaires aux États-Unis et en Afrique et des fondations majeures. Nous vous honorons, Sœur Jeanne, pour avoir été une femme religieuse pionnière, la première femme africaine à s'occuper de ses postes et ministères précédents et actuels.
Acceptance of this award, I will read out a short speech written by our sister, Sister Jane Wakahill. I am overwhelmed with gratitude to be considered for the award together with these phenomenal women. I congratulate the women receiving the award today for their exceptional work and commitment to the dignity and well-being of others. Thank you so much to you all for being here today to share this extraordinary moment with us. I accept this award in honor of so many Catholic sisters across the globe who are doing remarkable transformative work in undeserved and marginalized communities. These women are silently going about their work, making a difference one life at a time under very challenging circumstances. Sisters are an embodiment of vital church in Africa. Thank you for your fidelity, benevolence, and your vocations. With sincere gratitude, I receive this award in honor of the many women who tenaciously work and struggle to raise families and build our society from the bottom up. Women whose work is underappreciated, yet they contribute to nurturing faith and the vibrancy of the society. Women who toil all day on farms and in informal industries, working from dawn to dusk to support their families. I also accept this award in honor of my mother, Teresia Wamboi, a woman after my own heart, whose resilience, compassion, and unwavering love propelled me forward. With an encouraging, "You can do it," look reinforced me to stay on course. Thank you, Mom, there in heaven. A woman whose steadfast love, ethical values, discipline, and hard work shaped the person I am today. Mother, your love and voice of courage are etched in my heart forever. I am deeply indebted to women religious on whose shoulders I stand. I behold their hard work, courage, fortitude, and unwavering hope. Women like Mother Mary Kevin, founder of the Little Sisters of St. Francis, a selfless woman endowed with missionary zeal, transformative vision, and enduring love to educate women and girls. A woman who gave the totality of her life to improving human dignity and the common good in Africa. Taking the long journey from Ireland to Uganda in 1902 and founding the Little Sisters of St. Francis. It is our turn to leave the world a better place. We can do this together by holding each other's hand, building bridges of opportunities, and helping other women to climb the ladder of hope, one step at a time. We can do it and selflessly leave behind a trail, a legacy of love and care. I'm honored to have my sisters Judy and Irene present to receive this award on my behalf at my alma mater, the Catholic University of Eastern Africa. Thank you, Judy and Irene, my dearest sisters, for your continued encouragement and leaning in to support me in my religious vocation. Even when my hope is vacillating, I hear your voice calling me to soldier on. And to my dear friends and little sisters, thank you for your support along the journey. May God bless you all. Thank you, thank you, thank you. May God bless you all.
La personne suivante est Rose Ochieng. Mr. Rose Ochieng. Sister, come, please. Rose Ochieng est née en 1950 dans la sous-comté d'Ougenya, dans le comté de Siaya, dans la partie occidentale du Kenya, le long du lac Victoria. Elle est la troisième enfant d'une famille de sept enfants, dont deux garçons et cinq filles. Elle s'est mariée en 1975, à l'âge de 25 ans, et son mari est mort d'une maladie cardiaque après seulement 7 ans de mariage. Il a laissé veuve avec deux enfants, âgée de 7 et 5 ans, à Mombasa, une ville côtière du Kenya. Lorsqu'elle a refusé d'être épousée en héritage selon la tradition locale et la culture de sa tribu, sa vie est devenue vraiment difficile. Mais grâce à une foi et une espérance solide en Dieu, elle a réussi à marcher la tête haute et s'est autoproclamée une femme célibataire par chance et non par choix. Mama Otieng a beaucoup travaillé pour la situation de personnes démunies, des personnes âgées et des grands-mères qui y ont pris en charge des petits-enfants après les décès de leurs fils et de leurs filles à cause du sida. Et par l'intermédiaire de Canadian Samaritans for Africa, elle a créé une association nommée Triple C qui a réussi à supporter, à accorder un soutien éducatif à 70 enfants, à aider les femmes par le biais des microcrédits pour qu'elles puissent démarrer leurs activités génératrices de revenus. Et récemment, Triple C a réussi à ouvrir une nouvelle agence dans le comté de Sia, à l'ouest du Kenya. Mère de deux enfants biologiques, aujourd'hui adultes, Rose Ocheng s'est dit être également la mère de nombreux enfants de sa communauté. Mama Rose Ocheng, nous vous célébrons pour avoir été une femme courageuse, pour avoir ouvert votre cœur à ceux et à celles qui sont dans le besoin et pour avoir été les mains et les pieds du Christ Jésus.
Rose Ocheng was born in 1950 in Ugenya sub-county in Sia County in the western part of Kenya. She's a third-born child in a family of seven children. She was married at the age of 25. Her husband died of heart disease after only 7 years of marriage and left her with two children aged 7 years and 5 years. When she refused to be inherited according to local tradition and the culture of her tribe, her life became very difficult. But through strong faith and hope in God, she managed to walk with her head up and called herself a single woman by chance, not by choice. Her ministry included the elderly and the destitute in various centers where she met women, minors, and children engaged in sex work, drug and substance abuse. As she listened to their stories, she prayed to God to assist her to do something for them. She decided to undergo training as a counselor, psychologist, and proceeded to train in social work and community development through the sponsorship of the Society for Women AIDS in Kenya and the City Council of Mombasa. After which she began Triple C in 2001 to bridge the gap between caretakers and often vulnerable children. Through Canadian Samaritans for Africa, her organization has managed to give educational support to over 70 children, to assist women through microcredit finance, to train single mothers and or widows and women living positively with HIV/AIDS. She recently opened a new branch in Sia County. Rosa Chain is also a mother of many children in her community in addition to her own two. Mama Rosa Chain, we celebrate you for being a valiant woman, for opening your hearts to those in dire need, and for being the hands and feet of Christ.
Brothers and sisters, I'm humbled and happy to stand before you. As all has been said about Mama Rose, I just stand here and I cannot forget to give my sincere appreciation to my children, my biological two children, and children in the community, and my other children, many children in community, both in Mombasa, the coastal part of Kenya, and then Sia in the western part of Kenya, along the Lake Victoria. All he said, as popularly known as Mama Rose, I really appreciate. And there are two people. One is the late Professor Elizabeth Ngugi, or who started the Society for Women and AIDS in Kenya. She's my really and biological mentor, because without her, I could not be what I am. She brought me from nothing to something, and she has made me to stand here. Secondly, I give my sincere appreciation to Canadian Samaritan of Africa, CSA, through Father Stan, because Father Stan and the Canadian Samaritan of Africa has also made the women and the community, and now we are so many steps ahead from where we are. And whatever has been said about Mama Rose, all the challenges I came to learn from all those things, those challenges make us grow. And that is what made us to grow as per now. As it is said, Mama Rose was bereaved. The husband died long time ago, and she was left with two children. And one of the children who is here with me right now is also an adult, and that is none than Redemptor, who is now taking my photograph. Redemptor, come and stand us there. Just wave to the people. That is Redemptor, who was left when she was 5 years old, and without faith and hope, we could not be where we are today, and she could not be what she is now. And I'm very, very, very grateful and thankful to all and to everybody to have given me this opportunity to stand before you and to give me a lot of cooperation and to help me. And I wish that all without hope and without love, all is dimmed. So I welcome you all in the field of the Lord to work together as a team. And I wish you all so that we can start working in togetherness to build the work of our Almighty God in collaboration and networking in one way or the other. Otherwise, thank you so much, and thank you all. God bless you all.
Rosemary Nyirumbe, the youngest of 8 children, was born in 1956
and raised in a small village within Paita West Nile in Uganda. It is 122 miles and over 3 hours away from Gulu, where Sister Rosemary now lives. Sister Rosemary credits her love of children to the Italian Comboni sisters for her vocation, a call she answered at a young age of 15. In 2002, when Sister Rosemary was first assigned to St. Monica Girls Television Center in the northern Ugandan city of Gulu, her homeland was immersed in a violent and destructive tribal civil war. Throughout northern Uganda, the Lord's Resistant Army battled government forces to rule over the region. Terrified of being taken from their villages, children would walk to Gulu every evening, looking for protection. Sister Rosemary and the sisters took in every child, hiding them at St. Monica's in any possible space, housing 300 to 500 children every night.
From the community of St. Egidio, she received money to buy them food, mattresses, blankets, and other needs. Boys who escaped the
LRA militia were able to return home and go to school, but in Uganda's tribal culture, girls who escaped, often arriving with their own children born of rape, were rejected by their families and unwanted by the community. So Sister Rosemary started a daycare for the little ones and a literacy program for the girls. Then she began to teach them a trade to empower their hearts and their will with vocations as seamstresses, cooks, or hairdressers. St. Monica's Girl Tailoring Center in Gulu, home to 400 girls and young women, has enrolled more than 2,000 girls in the past 16 years. Sister Rosemary and her community, the Sacred Heart of Jesus Congregation, have expanded their work in the region, opening schools and centers in Adjumani and a 100-acre farm in Atiak, where they also serve women, children, and orphans fleeing from the current violence in South Sudan. Sister Rosemary, we honor your laughter and sense of humor, but more so, your nurturing spirit that has provided healing to many souls traumatized by the violence of war and forced displacement, and also instilling renewed hope in their hearts.
La révérende sœur Rosemary Nirumbe est la plus jeune enfant d'une famille de 8 enfants. Elle est née en 1956 et elle a grandi dans un petit village de Païda en Ouganda. Et ce village se trouve à 122 km et à 3 heures de Goulou, où elle vit actuellement. La sœur Rosemary attribue sa vocation à son amour des enfants et aux sœurs comboniennes italiennes. Et elle a reçu un appel auquel elle a répondu dès l'âge de 15 ans. De la communauté de Saint-Égidio, elle a reçu de l'argent et les moyens pour pouvoir prendre en charge les enfants victimes de la rébellion de Joseph Kony. Et elle a pu créer beaucoup d'activités pour venir aider aux enfants, entre autres un centre pour les filles à Sainte-Monique à Goulou qui accueille 400 enfants et de jeunes femmes. Elle a inscrit plus de 2000 filles en classe au cours des 16 dernières années. Et la sœur et sa communauté ont étendu le travail dans la région, ouvrant des écoles et des centres à Moyo, à Djoumani, et une ferme de 100 hectares à Atiak, où ils s'occupent également des femmes, des enfants orphelins fuyant la violence actuelle au Sud-Soudan. Sœur Rosemary, nous rendons hommage à votre rire et à votre sens de l'humour, mais surtout à votre esprit nourricier qui a permis de guérir de nombreuses âmes traumatisées par la violence de la guerre et des déplacements forcés et d'insuffler un nouvel espoir dans leur cœur.
Honor for me to receive this award. And I must say, I have been surprised and I feel really, really humbled. But at the same time, I want to say I'm receiving this award on behalf of those women who society has named the voiceless, school dropouts, vulnerable women and children. I want to say these are people who have a voice, but their voice are not easily heard. And at the same time, we give them different names, which is not who they are. All the description we give them is not exactly who they are. I want to thank the organizers of this Congress very much for considering me worthy of this award. I know it is a long journey that I have walked, but I did not walk alone. That is why I have been slow, because I did not walk alone. I got that proverb very well, that if you want to go fast, you go alone. For this reason, I want to say I received this award also on behalf of the Sisters of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, who have supported me all along the way, who have worked with me, who have made it that what we are doing to support the vulnerable women and children become part of our charism. I want to thank the Sacred Heart of Jesus, who has enlightened the sisters to know that this is our real mission. This is where God keeps calling us, that we should walk alongside the poor, alongside those people living at the periphery, those people whose voice cannot easily be heard. I thank you all because you have heard what sowing hope is all about, and I will not ask any of you to give me a definition of hope. No one can define hope. You got to live it, you got to walk and find exactly where you belong. And at this point, as we celebrate, and as we talk a lot about the synodality, I would like to invite all of you this time to hold a needle in your hands. Not because you want to enjoy holding a needle. I want you to learn to sew mend your clothes, mend the broken lives in your society. Learn to make these bags. Learn to feel the pain of a needle. Learn to feel the difficulties of making this. That means you are coming in exactly to mend the broken life of a person, one person at a time. I want you to get pricked by the needle, and that will be your journey to giving hope. Thank you so much, and I invite all of you to hold a needle with thread and start sewing the lives of everybody, especially this time when we talk about synodality. Let's sew together. Thank you so much.
La récipiendaire suivante est la révérende sœur Anne-Marie Béatrice Fayet. Elle est sénégalaise, religieuse de la congrégation des sœurs de Notre-Dame, de l'Immaculée Conception de Castres. Elle est docteur en philosophie de l'université Cheikh Anta Diop de Dakar au Sénégal. Après 5 ans de travail, de mission à Rome comme membre de l'équipe générale de son institut, elle est depuis octobre 2013 en mission au Burkina Faso pour la formation des jeunes et s'intéresse à la question de la promotion de la femme dans le contexte de l'Afrique. Elle est professeure de philosophie au Centre Saint-Augustin de Dakar et au Grand Séminaire interdiocésain à Brun, membre de l'ATA, Association des théologiens africains, coordinatrice du groupe africain de recherche en philosophie interculturelle, GARPI. Elle est aussi membre du conseil académique de l'Institut œcuménique Al-Mofaka au Maroc, Rabat. Elle est aussi professeure de philosophie dans ce même institut. Elle est également membre de l'Académie africaine des sciences religieuses, sociales et politiques. Depuis juin 2021, elle est membre de la commission des théologiens pour le prochain synode en 2023. Sœur Anne-Béatrice Fayet, nous célébrons vos réalisations dans le domaine académique et pour avoir porté fièrement le drapeau de l'Afrique sur la scène mondiale grâce à votre travail avec le Vatican et en tant que membre du conseil d'administration de Concilium.
Anne-Béatrice Fayet, a Senegalese nun of the Congregation of the Sisters of Our Lady of the Immaculate Conception of Castres. She earned her Doctor of Philosophy at Cheikh Anta Diop University in Dakar, Senegal. After 5 years of mission in Rome as a member of the general team of her institute, she has been on mission in Burkina Faso since October 2013 for the formation of young people. She's interested in the promotion of women in the African context, professor of philosophy at the St. Augustine Center in Dakar, and at the major interdiocesan seminary in Brun. She's also a member of the Association of African Theologians, a member of the Academic Council of the Ecumenical Institute Al-Mouafaka in Morocco, Rabat. She's also a professor of philosophy in the same institute. Sister Beatrice is also a member of the African Academy of Religious, Social, and Political Sciences. Since June 2021, she has been a member of the Commission of Theologians for the next synod in 2023. Sister Anne-Beatrice Faye, we celebrate your accomplishments in the academic field and for proudly flying Africa's flag on the global stage through your work with the Vatican and as a board member of Concilium.
Bonsoir tout le monde. Je suis timide, mais je me soigne pour ça. Vraiment, je n'étais pas venue à Nairobi pour recevoir ce trophée, mais je voudrais offrir cela d'abord à ma mère. C'est, elle n'est plus là. C'est une grande dame pour moi qui m'a façonnée et qui a fait de moi ce que je suis aujourd'hui. Je dédie aussi ce trophée à toutes les femmes d'Afrique, celles qui me donnent la force et qui m'inspirent dans mes recherches, dans mon travail, dans ma mission. Et je pense particulièrement ce soir à tous ces moments de notre mission, modeste mission à Zoré, au Burkina Faso. Ce sont elles particulièrement qui m'inspirent chaque fois que je les rencontre. Et avec elles, je rends grâce au Seigneur ce soir. Et j'étais très émue d'entendre la conférence de Madame Mary qui a parlé de Maman Africa. L'Afrique est vraiment notre mère. Et l'Afrique est une mère. C'est elle que nous célébrons ce soir. Merci beaucoup. Merci à l'association que nous avons visitée au quartier. Et j'étais très émue de rencontrer cette grande dame qui m'inspire aussi. Et désormais, elle fait partie des figures féminines que j'essaye de découvrir et de revisiter au niveau de notre continent. Merci.
She joined the Congregation of the Sisters of St. Andrew, where she took her first vows in 1979 and her perpetual vows in 1993. After studying philosophy at the Major Seminary of Lubumbashi, she pursued further theological studies from 84 to 89 at the Catholic University of Lyon in France. After a year of English studies, she studied ecumenism and interreligious dialogue in Birmingham, UK. From 1997 to 2000, she enrolled for a doctorate at the Catholic University of Lyon and defended her thesis. Sister Galula currently teaches in several theological institutes on the African continent. She is a professor at the Faculty of Theology of the Catholic University of Congo and also at the Al-Mouam Fakha Ecumenical Institute in Rabat, Morocco. Sister Josie holds the honor of being the first African woman to be appointed to the International Theological Commission. We honor you for your truly humble nature, but also your pioneering work in the field of theology, and especially in tackling difficult but necessary topics such as the abuse of nuns.
Originaire de la République démocratique du Congo, la révérende sœur José Ngalula est née à Kinshasa le 28 janvier 1960.
Il a fréquenté l'école primaire de Kinshasa avant d'entrer au lycée Kimwenza de Kinshasa. Il entre dans la congrégation des Sœurs de Saint-André, où il prononce ses premiers vœux et en 1979 et ses vœux perpétuels le 21 mai 1993. Après des études de philosophie de 81 à 83 au grand séminaire de Lubumbashi, il a poursuivi ses études de théologie de 1984 à 1989 à l'Université catholique de Lyon en France. Après une année d'études en anglais de 1989 à 1990, il a étudié l'œcuménisme, le dialogue interreligieux à Birmingham, au Royaume-Uni. De 1997 à 2000, il s'inscrit pour un doctorat à l'Université catholique de Lyon, un doctorat qu'elle a soutenu en 2000. Sœur Ngalula enseigne dans plusieurs instituts de théologie du continent africain. Il est professeur à la faculté de théologie de l'Université catholique du Congo et également à l'Institut œcuménique Al-Mouafaka à Rabat au Maroc. Sœur José a l'honneur d'être la première femme africaine à être nommée à la Commission théologique internationale. Révérende Sœur José, nous vous honorons pour votre nature vraiment humble, mais aussi pour votre travail de pionnière dans le domaine de la théologie et en particulier pour avoir abordé des sujets extrêmement difficiles mais nécessaires tels que l'abus des religieuses.
Bonsoir à toutes, à tous. Good evening, everybody. It's true that I am humble. C'est vrai que je suis humble et c'est difficile d'avoir, de parler beaucoup et longtemps quand on est humble. J'ai dit seulement le mot le plus important, c'est merci. Merci à Dieu, merci à mon Église catholique. Merci à ma congrégation, les sœurs de Saint-André. Merci à tous les hommes, toutes les femmes qui m'ont façonnée depuis ma naissance jusqu'à cet après-midi, parce que toutes les conférences que je reçois ici continuent à me façonner. Merci, merci, merci.
Le dernier groupe récipiendaire est l'Association des femmes consacrées en Afrique orientale et centrale, en sigle APOECA. Fondée en 1974, l'Association des femmes consacrées de l'Afrique de l'Est et du Centre est un organisme régional comprenant des associations nationales de sororité femmes supérieures générales des 10 pays anglophones de l'Afrique de l'Est et du Centre. L'APOECA a réalisé de nombreuses actions remarquables au fil des ans et nous sommes reconnaissants à ses sœurs fondatrices pionnières pour leur vision et leur suivi, ainsi qu'à d'innombrables autres personnes qui les ont dirigées avec compétence au cours des années suivantes. Voici quelques-unes de leurs actions et de leurs projets actuels. Le programme
Leadership for Mission, qui répond aux besoins de l'APOECA de développer la formation et le leadership en fonction des besoins de la société. Le projet SCORE E7, c'est-à-dire l'APOECA en collaboration avec Catholic Relief Services, coordonne le projet SCORE pour encourager les femmes dans le développement des capacités. Leur objectif, c'est de faire en sorte que les enfants âgés de 0 à 3 ans dans des zones cibles vivent dans des environnements plus stimulants d'ici 2024. Un autre projet, Sisters Blended Value. Leur objectif dans ce projet est de transformer les ministères sociaux des femmes religieuses en entreprises sociales durables. En général, l'APOECA donne aux femmes consacrées les moyens d'une évangélisation plus profonde dans l'Église et dans la société. Sont représentées aujourd'hui par plusieurs membres du secrétariat, parmi lesquels la révérende sœur Wilhelmina Tounou, qui est chargée du programme pour SCORE et qui est aussi la secrétaire générale adjointe. La révérende sœur Leonida Chamanula, qui est la responsable des finances. La révérende sœur Elisabeth Parakouo, qui est la comptable. Madame Judith Mweni, qui est l'assistante des communications. Et la révérende sœur Brigitte Samba, qui est la secrétaire générale. APOECA, nous vous célébrons pour votre travail de pionnier dans l'autonomisation des femmes religieuses et dans la construction d'un réseau solide de sœurs catholiques.
Founded in 1974, the Association of Consecrated Women in East and Central Africa, APOECA, is a regional body comprising of national associations of sisterhoods from 10 English-speaking countries of East and Central Africa. APOECA has achieved many remarkable actions over the years, and we are grateful to their pioneering founding sisters for the vision and follow through, and countless others who have steered ably over the subsequent years. Some of their current projects include the Leadership Formation Program, which responds to a PECA's need to develop formation and leadership in accordance with the needs of the present society, the SCORE ECD project, where a PECA in collaboration with Catholic Relief Services coordinates the strengthening the capacity of religious women in early childhood development. The goal is that the children aged 0 to 3 years in target areas live in nurturing environments by 2024. And the Sisters Blended Valley Project. The goal of this project is to transform the social ministries of religious women into sustainable social enterprises. In general, APECA empowers consecrated women for deeper evangelization in the church and society. Represented here today by several members of the current secretariat, our Sister Wilhelmina Tulu, the program officer for SCORE ECD and the Deputy Secretary General, Sister Leonida Shamanula, the finance officer, Sister Elizabeth Parakor, the accountant, Judith Mweni, the communication assistant, and Sister Brigitta Samba, the secretary general. APECA, we celebrate you for your pioneering work empowering women religious and building a strong network of African Catholic sisters.
Indeed, we are honored and humbled to be awarded this evening among this auspicious group here. And we don't take this for granted. This is an award and honor not only for the Secretariat of APECA, but for all religious women in Eastern and Central Africa. 10 countries, as we've heard. And we thank you all, and especially we thank the sisters here present and all the sisters all over. We have one board member of APECA with us here, Sister Josephine of Association of Sisterhoods of Kenya, represented here. We are grateful, and this is an award for all sisters and also for the women, children, communities that sisters serve all over Eastern and Central Africa. We thank all the congregations in the region, and we thank the church in which we celebrate. And we heard recently Pope Francis saying, we cannot imagine a church without religious sisters. And with this, we are very grateful, and especially for the organizers of this Pan-African Congress on Theology, for honoring the APECA sisters with this evening. Thank you, and God bless you all.
Thank you. I would ask that you give a rousing hand of applause for all our honorees of this evening.
So much, Sister Mombe and Father Emmanuel, Sir Solaj, and Sister Mary Gitui. We appreciate and we clap for them as well. We clap for them.
And as we clap, I call upon the Zoko team to come forward. The Zoko team to come forward, please. And come faster so that we may save time. Sir Rosemary, join them. Please come forward, Zoko team. Please come forward. Yes, Leonardo, please, you clap for them and they come. Yes, voila. Yes, voila. Come on.
Come forward. Yes, my member. Zoko. Martine. Sor Natalia. Zoko. From it's a song sung by someone called Anselm is from Ivory Coast, and we have so many persons here in this house from Ivory Coast. So if you know you are Ivorian, please come forward. Please.
Toutes les Ivoiriennes et les Ivoiriens qui sont là, on vous voit ici. Les hommes, les femmes ivoiriens, venez. Docteur Brou et les restes. En avant. DJ, musique. Il faut vous réchauffer. Réchauffez-vous pour la danse.
Thank you.
Nigeria has happened. Today it is Ivory Coast has happened. Ivory Coast has happened. Today not Nigeria. Father Ikenna, today Ivory Coast has happened. No, Ivory Coast has happened. Thank you. Now, we are about to close. Please, as you sort of call upon Eric, our tenor, please. He has something to tell us this evening. Eric Karibu. Karibu. Say asante. Karibu. No, asante.
Asante. Tonight is for the women. So we will sing a song for the women. And this song is Swahili song.
Malaika. You're the king of the town. You're the king.
Knows what that means, but okay. That's Igbo. You clap for him, please.
Yeah. Now we've come to the end of our day, and we appreciate everyone present here. Please clap for yourself wherever you're seated and appreciate yourself. We appreciate all the persons who stood here and said something, and even those who stood here and smiled. We appreciate them by clap, please. And we appreciate the organizers of this evening. And we pray that God may continue blessing them as we clap for them. And we appreciate ourselves. I, Leonida Katunge, and clap for us. Thank you. God bless you. Have a great evening. You stand up and sing a hymn of Mary as we proceed, as we exit from this house.
Thank you.